morning, Spain. How lovely to have you with us once again. Today we're going to be travelling to Valencia to meet up with our reporter, Princess Keisha Omilana. We're also going to be travelling to Asturias, possibly one of my favourite places on the planet. And talking about planets, are yours aligned? Let's find out with our astrologer, Lady B. Hannah Murray in All Things Books is going to be giving us information on more fiction set in Spain, some great recommended books, and Chef Nick Newman cooking up a lovely traditional Spanish dish, but simplified so that it's possible for everybody. We're going to be seeing what it's like to do aerial acrobatics with silks with the lovely Kate, and also learn a bit about hypnosis, two great ways to disconnect but in completely different ways, I have to say. Nando Brown is back snouting and abouting with information on how to look after our pets, particularly our dogs, to the best of our abilities, but also chatting a little bit about AI, artificial intelligence, something that's really touching all of our lives in some way. So many things to get through in the program, that's just part of the lineup, so join us. Starting off this week's program, welcoming again our lovely Kate and also Tam. Good morning, girls.
Good morning.
Tam, sweetheart, you specialize in different therapies to help people focus, relax, be themselves, their mm-hmm. best selves. And I know one of those aspects is hypnosis, and you hypnotized our lovely Kate. What is this hypnosis? What, in layman's terms, so we can all understand?
Sure. So to explain hypnosis in a super simple way, hypnosis is to go into a trance-like state. And the best way I can give you an example of this is when you're watching your favorite TV show, Spain. You are completely focused on watching your favorite show. Everything disappears, the walls, the curtains, the sofa, the cushions, everything. And you are completely focused on that show, and your thoughts and your feelings are directed in that way. So another way that we can explain it is that when you are driving in the car and you're suddenly at your destination,
yes,
and you're like, oh my
so
God,
many times.
How did I get
scary.
Here? Yeah, but the body knows how to drive, so we get to our destination, but this is a time distortion where everything else disappears. So
that is a great analogy, because I think a lot of us, anyway, if we drive, can relate to that you're driving and then you're so in your head, and then you're crossed a bridge or at a certain part of the journey, and it's like, how on earth did I get here?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
As you say, it can be quite scary sometimes, isn't it? When you do arrive home and you think, which way did I go? How did I get here?
Yeah, or it's like when you're out with for dinner with friends and like suddenly it's like goodness knows what time, and like, where did the time go? Because you are only focused in that area, and that's a trance-like state.
And that is the objective of hypnosis, is to take us intentionally into that state,
mm-hmm,
that
different
vibe
state.
And when we're there, what's the benefit?
So the benefit is that we can create whatever we want in a trance-like state. So when I did when I invited Kate to do the hypnosis with me, we did health, happiness and love. So we enhanced these areas of her life. We know Kate, she's always happy and smiley, but you can always enhance what you already have. So we can enhance love, we can enhance happiness, we can enhance relaxation. But it can be used for so many different things as well. Hypnosis can be used for things like addictions, gambling, smoking, drinking, things like that. So it can create an easier, happier life for someone, or it can enhance what you already have. So many celebrities or athletes have hypnosis before they go on stage or play a game, because it's really going to help their performance.
I suppose at crucial moments, if you're playing that final shot at Wimbledon, being able to stay focused and
Absolutely.
In your own space and your own mind and not lose yourself to the outside world must be very important.
Mm-hmm.
Or doing an exam, or
exactly.
even going into an interview or an important meeting, anything. And what did you feel, Kate, when you were in it?
I think, as you said, I think you have to be open to someone actually kind of getting you into that state. And I think obviously Tamsin's so lovely, so you know, I felt so comfortable. I felt very relaxed. I loved it.
A great way of therapy. Another great therapy for a lot of people is shopping. So let's join now Princess Keisha Omilana, because we're going to visit her favorite Valencian designer. Make my day. Make my
day. I'm Princess Keisha Omilana, your Valencian correspondent, and today I'm taking you inside the atelier of Isobel Serrano. She's one of my absolute favorite designers in Valencia, and she makes clothes for the everyday modern woman. As you can see, this is one of her pieces. I absolutely love it. And now let's go inside and have a word with her to find out why she is the fashion designer you need to see.
Fine, thank you.
Well, I'm here because you make the most beautiful clothes for everyday wear for all women, for every occasion.
Okay.
What would you say this piece, perfect for the first date, right?
Yes. This is perfect.
Beautiful. I love the details. Mm-hmm. The color, amazing. And what would you say is a great piece for the workplace if you're a businesswoman?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, very lovely. Look at the detail. Mm-hmm. You're sure to close a power deal with this blazer. Going to maybe a cocktail event for friends and girlfriends. What would you? Very nice. Beautiful. Detail.
This is silk.
Everyone's favorite fabric is silk, right? So, guys, when you're coming to Valencia, you have to come to visit Isobel. She has a piece for everyday wear, whether you're going to a cocktail dinner, a wedding, going to the office, she has you covered. Isobel, thank you so much for having me in your atelier today.
Thank you. My atelier is always open for you.
Thank you. And it's open for you as well. When you are in Valencia, you have to come to visit Isobel Serrano's atelier. She's located just 20 minutes outside of Valencia. And when you come, she has clothes for all women, all sizes, all shapes, and for every occasion. She's one of my favorites in Valencia, and I'm 100% sure she's going to be your favorite as well. Make sure you come and visit.
Good morning, Nando. Lovely to see you.
Good morning.
Good morning, and good morning to you, Lady B.
Hello, it's nice to be here.
Nice to have you back in Spain. And once again, a monthly update of what we can expect from the stars and the planets, because what we're talking about, the retrogrades and the disagrade, and it still doesn't mean very much to me, although I like to read my horoscope in the paper. I find it fascinating.
I think most people do, don't they? They like to just have a quick read at the back of the paper and see what's going on for like their daily sort of horoscope. But mentioning retrogrades that you just said, we are currently in Mercury retrograde, which is a big one that most people that don't even sort of have that much knowledge about astrology always know when it's time for Mercury retrograde. It basically starts at the beginning of April and it goes right the way through to the 25th. And for people that don't really know that much about what it means, it's that time when communications go wrong, travel plans always fall through, computers break down, Hannah, who's on the show, who I saw yesterday because I flew in yesterday, her washing machine's broken, the laptop doesn't work. It's always these things where Mercury, which is a planet that goes into retrograde, these things always happen because it's the planet around communication, planning. And when it's in retrograde, these things just happen. And you kind of go, hang on, why is everything breaking? And you look to it and you go, oh, Mercury retrograde. And we're in that at the moment. So people watching, if things are going wrong, we should be out of it by the end of April, which is good.
But why? What is it that this retrograde does? What is happening with Mercury?
So basically what it means, it means that Mercury is going, when you look at the planets, it looks like it's going backwards, but in actual fact, it's an optical illusion. It just means that it's to do with the speed of the planets. And when a planet is in retrograde, it's almost like it's going backwards.
Anti-clockwise, kind of spinning.
And it's to do with the speed of the planets. And basically, when that happens, because Mercury is the planet responsible for communication, travel, planning, all that sort of stuff, it has a knock-on effect, what's going on in society, in our day-to-day lives. But it's actually an optical illusion because the planet is still going the same way, but because of the difference in the speed at this particular time, it looks like Mercury is going backwards. And from an astrologer's point of view, there's always then the effect of what's going on in our day-to-day lives. So we're in it at the moment. So you said that at the start, so that was just a good point. But we're also in Aries season because we're in April. So that's the star sign of this month. And it's a fire sign. It's a sign that if you know people that are Aries, they're very passionate, they're very creative, they're very driven. And that's where we are at the moment in Aries season.
And what can people expect for Aries season? Do we have moons in or planets in retrograde? Are there rather like an overwhelming influence of something?
Yeah, so what we had on April the 8th, at the start of the month, we had a solar eclipse. And people probably saw it on the news because people could in the States could actually see it. We couldn't see it in the UK. We couldn't see it much here. And that was a solar eclipse that started in Aries. And what that means is we then have to look at obviously like the lunar cycle and what's going on with the moon and all the other planets. But it's just a time of new beginnings, getting things in action. And because the eclipse was in Aries, it has that passion, that drive, that energy. So if you want to start new projects, new plans, get new things in place, you know, be driven and start a new relationship, something like that, it's a good time with it in the fiery, creative, visionary Aries. It's a good time to start all those projects, get things done. But you also be mindful that we are in retrograde with Mercury. So things like signing documents, making those kind of things, just, you know, be more mindful when you're doing it.
You're what star sign, Nando?
I'm a Sagittarius, but I'm incredibly ignorant when it comes to this kind of stuff. I have no idea.
You don't ever look at your horoscope?
I don't look at my horoscope, no.
Oh, but do you mean your life doesn't revolve around what's going on?
It's all about work. But interesting, so Sagittarius is a fire sign, Aries is a fire sign, and Leo is a fire sign. So those are the three fire signs. Obviously, there's all different elements, but this is the fire month, so you're fire. And it's really interesting because people that don't buy into it or don't have that much knowledge of it, when you start to look deeper into it, you see that the people that you have relationships with or friendships with, you naturally have an affinity to those signs. And you don't always ask it because it's not on your radar, it's not in your life. But for example, so if you're like Sagittarius, you'll be attracted to say an Aries or a Leo because they have lots of fiery energy and it complements your nature and you're adventurous and you like doing stuff. And you tend to be drawn to the same sort of people. And it's only until you start looking a bit more deeply into it and digging a bit deeper, you sort of go, oh, hang on. I'm always going out with Taurus, or oh, I get on really well with Scorpio, or oh, I like women that are, or men that are this. And you kind of see that there's a pattern in your relationships and friendships. But with Aries, they are fire signs, but when you have a relationship, generally like a romantic relationship, you tend to be attracted to people that you're opposite sign of the zodiac wheel. So you could be, if you were an Aries, that would be Libra. And what that does is it provides the sort of the opposite traits that you don't have. So in a relationship setting, it becomes quite complementary. So Libras are quite balanced and quite giving and more harmonious. And Aries are very fiery and driven. So it creates that balance and that harmony in a relationship. So you're Taurus, aren't you? So Taurus, and most of my friends, I have a lot of Taurian friends, their partners are Scorpio, and that's their opposite sign. And they have friendships with Scorpio. So it's even though you have an affinity with the fire signs, like Sagittarius, I'm Leo, an Aries, you also have an affinity with people that you're opposite sign because it fills in those blanks that you don't have, which leads to quite a nice balance in a relationship.
I've got a question. So when we talk about when we talk about like the star signs and everything, it's always you're this, so you're that. Like, so you're like, you're a Sagittarius, so you're adventurous and fiery. Mm. You're never like, you're shit at accountants, or you're rubbish with this, and you're really bad.
They do have negative sides.
Oh, okay.
As well. Yeah.
What am I bad at? Tell me.
Sagittarians are quite impulsive.
That's true.
and also they take risks. You know, they don't kind of go, they're not plodders and planners. They go, right, I want to do that today. I'm going to get up, sun shining, so there's always a balance. So I'm sure you like take risks, love new challenges, you know, but then you'll do stuff sometimes and go, oh, hang on, why did I do that? Do you know what I mean?
Only when it goes wrong.
Is that what I mean? Maybe that's because you've just gone gung-ho straight in, rather than somebody more ploddy, like a Virgo, for example, might think, what about this? What about that? I don't like risk.
You mean like cycling off a mountain? Just assuming that there's going to be something the other side.
There is that.
So you always have the negative. So like Aries season at the moment. So Aries can be very impulsive as well. can be quite aggressive. You know, they're very impatient. They want things done now. You know, so if there was something like a Libra who's a bit more sedate, it's but then when you're looking at we're looking at sun signs at the moment, because that's what in the horoscopes, in the papers, it's all sun signs. But then you do have moon signs and different planets in different parts of your chart. So it becomes a lot more in depth. We're just looking at moon signs, which is a tiny little part of your whole astrological profile. So, but generally the main characteristics, even if people don't believe, if I do readings or I do charts with people or just, you know, meet people and look at relationships and friendships, you can see that I can go, oh, you're such a Pisces, or you are such a Sagittarius. You are fun-loving, daring, adventurous, sport. You know, you like to do all these things. You're very Taurian. So the traits, even though people kind of go, oh, is it real? They kind of, you can just see it. You can see it in the stars.
It really is written in the stars.
It's written in the stars, like that lovely song.
How long does it take you to prepare somebody's astrological
chart? If you're doing a chart, it's quite an in-depth process. I can sit down for a whole day, because you've got to go through every position, every planet. There's so much to it. It takes a good long time to do that. A tarot reading is slightly quicker, because you can sit down and you've got cards, so you've got the tool there and the energy and the connection, so it's quicker. But an actual birth chart, so you'll need your time of birth, your date of birth, time of birth, location, and then you look at all the planets, where they were placed when you were born. So it's very intricate, in depth, but it's fascinating. You can find out about love, relationships, divorce, you know, what's going on with your work, what should you do, what industry should you work in, where should you live? I mean, there's so many, when you start digging into all the different houses, it gives you so much information. It's fascinating.
It's fascinating. And what's the difference between, say, a tarot reading than your astrological chart?
So tarot is just another tool, but it's more for guidance, intuition, connection,
energy. Day-to-day stuff.
Day-to-day stuff, yeah. And so, and also what you do, I have the cards and you pick the cards with your energy and what's going on with you, and you look at what you've chosen and see where you're at, and you're like, I've got my cards with me. I'll do you a reading later.
Because we have to go, because we've got things to do. Nikki, thank you so much. Lady B, lovely to have you with us again. And Nando, nice to know more about you.
This segment is sponsored by the School of Integrative Healing.
When anyone talks about trust, I can always just see the snake, I think his name's Carl, from the jungle, trust in me. But we need to trust in ourselves more than in other people. And the lovely Hannah Alonso Bartlett is joining us again today to give us some tips on just how to do that. Good morning, Hannah.
Good morning.
You look absolutely gorgeous, joyous. Spring has sprung.
Well, I'm very pleased because I feel that I'm matching the couch. This is an accident,
exactly.
But I'm
you
very
fit
happy
in the
about
studio
this.
Beautifully, so exactly. You may stay.
So we've been talking about astrology. I may stay. Thank you. I didn't know that was in question.
Decoratively pleasing, so you may.
My Virgo is very pleased with this. I'm like, this is excellent. We're talking about astrology today, so I'm like, this is the organisation here.
But fantastic. It is, when things align, they just fall into place beautifully. And it's lovely to see you again, but also to talk about a subject which I think is fundamental, learning to trust oneself. Mm-hmm. Why don't we? How can we?
So there's an interesting thing around self-trust. We think that, you know, to move fast, to trust ourselves, we have to have a high level of confidence, right? But how do we build confidence? We build confidence by moving and just doing the things, right? And then you see, oh, I did that. I was able to do that. And so a lot of people get stuck in, oh, I've got to be ready, or, you know, I've got to feel 100% sure to move on something. So trusting yourself doesn't mean that you feel 100% perfect with every decision. It doesn't mean that you have got 100% confidence. It just means that when you're given opportunities, you allow yourself to say yes, right? That you, it's for me, it's the difference between being stagnant and actually being in flow with life. Life is always flowing. We can't actually be stuck as long as we're moving with life, right? But we get in our heads, oh, I don't know, right? I've got to know everything perfectly. It's like, when I was offered to come on to Good Morning, right? I was really nervous. I've never done TV before. And I was saying to my team, oh, I don't know. I don't know if I can do this. I don't know. I've never been on camera in this way. What if I do? You know, our brain goes on this journey. What if I do a terrible job? What if everyone hates me? What if I don't wear the right dress and it doesn't match the couch? You know,
important matters of life.
What if I don't know the exact color of the pillows? And so imagine that I'd got into this kind of place of, okay, I'm not going to do it because I'm not 100% sure, because our brain plays tricks on us, doesn't it? It tells us.
Always.
It tells us all these things. So what trusting yourself is, okay, I'll figure it out on the way. I'm just going to do it. As much as I've got resistance, as much as my brain is telling me, oh, Han, can you really do this? Who are you to do this, right? It's just still moving on it, right? So it's not a perfect state, but it's just allowing ourselves to move with the opportunities that we're given.
Really is important to do anything, I think, to trust ourselves. But there is the external pressure from media, advertising, colleagues at work, friends at school, parents, that sometimes so forcefully give an opinion that is against what we believe, that then it becomes difficult to actually know what one is actually thinking about for themselves and that is in best interest. How can we overcome this? How can we take those initial steps to take the steps, as you say, to move forward and not just stagnantly doubt?
So there are many things. First thing, we need to come to peace with failure, right? So why do we not want to move on something? We're like, what if I fail? What if I, you're going to fail in life, right? But actually there's no such thing as failure, because if you learn something, then that was brilliant, right? So I think the reason that we don't move forward in life, we don't make decisions, we don't, you know, just trust the feeling that we've got and go, is because we think, oh, I've got to get this perfect. I've got to make the perfect next move in my life, right? I have a business, right? So I see a lot of people do this in business. Oh, I don't know, should I go with that mentor? Should I go with that coach? Should I launch this program? And they want to do it right. Let go of right, right?
There is no right.
And just right for now, right? Good enough for now, yeah? Because, you know, I look at my business trajectory and we grew very fast because I preferred to make a choice than to stay in indecision. Even if that choice meant that I took a slightly bizarre path there, I was like, I'm going to get where I want to go anyway. So we want to be really releasing the fear of failure, really releasing any judgment about getting it wrong or right, releasing any thoughts about you can get it wrong or right, and just move, just take the next step. I used to run half marathons. My father was a marathon runner. And I would beat a lot of men, which would really annoy them. You'd watch them, they'd put their, you know, arms in front of me in the New Zealand mountains. And I would see their strategy. Their strategy would be, they've got their stopwatch, right? And their stopwatch, what is it? The timer thing on their wrist. As you can tell, I did not do that. And they're like trying to do it perfect and their training is perfect. My strategy was put one foot in front of the other and keep going and stay steady.
Thank you ever so much, Hannah. Really appreciate that. And it's nice to talk about things that sometimes make us uncomfortable, but if we talk about them, then they become more natural and easier to do. Now we're going to visit Asturias. I mentioned at the beginning of the program, it is one of my favorite places. It's so green, it's so Spanish, and the food is amazing. The beaches are spectacular. Asturias is just Asturias. We'll be right back.
In fact, Asturias is considered to be the cradle of rural tourism. With over 18,000 beds of charming lodging, more than a third of the landscape is protected with 6 biosphere reserves. Sea and mountains, territory of adventure. Ethnography in a living state. Gastronomy in communion with nature. Return to the origin. Disconnect from the rush. Connect with life.
That our lovely Lady B, whose name is Nikki, knows a lot about artificial intelligence and is quite interested about it, which I thought is nice to therefore discuss with Nando's introduction to AI and basically the need for us to embrace it. I'm of an age that I'm more scared of it than wanting to use it, although I do to a certain degree. But Nando, you're very enthusiastic, I think might be the appropriate word, about its abilities and possibilities.
Yeah, I am. I'm really enthusiastic about it. And I think there's a lot of benefits that can come from it. And I think a couple of weeks ago, we spoke about the Malaga police launching their new AI dog. So, and there was quite a bit of kickback about that. It was quite a few people that were interested and a bit worried about it. But for me, it's not something that we should be really worried about. It's something we should start embracing because it's coming. Like there's no stopping it. But as soon as you talk about AI, people assume like Terminator 2 is happening. Like,
I'm right there. That is the way I associate it.
I think they assume the worst as well, don't they? They kind of go, ooh, because it's unknown. And
that's
they don't know about it. The ignorance can lead to the wrong conclusion.
Is it unknown? Are these movies, or are they just an insight into what's to come?
Yes, I think it is.
I mean, for me, I can't see that it could be anything but. I mentioned to you that I saw this question going on, and it was saying about the humans, and it was like almost like this robot was patronizing, oh no, we'll never have the intelligence of a human, we'll never be there. And it was like, this is scary, this is very tongue-in-cheek by this robot saying
cheeky.
Scarily cheeky.
But you can program it to be cheeky like that, and that's within our control. Let's start at the beginning.
Don't they learn when they do it? So it's almost like a kind of, not you're programming it for the different emotions, they can do it, and then they learn and create their own ability to their own responses.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Like, so the definition of artificial intelligence is basically a machine mimicking human intelligence, and it's been around for ages.
Yeah.
Like, and nobody's been scared of it up until this point. Like,
it's the point that it's reached.
Yeah.
It's the amount of how many people
how
now are using ChatGPT.
Yeah.
So since they launched it a year ago, basically, to the public of free access, and from that moment to now, how much has it learned from the millions of people who are using it?
Oh,
too much.
Yeah.
It's so much, and it's happening at such a quick rate, which is why I think people are so concerned about it at the moment. But if you think back to the iPhone, when Siri came out, nobody was worried about Siri.
I was. Don't use it.
I didn't like Alexa.
Sharing my life with her.
Didn't like Alexa in the kitchen.
I was given one. I gave it away.
Yeah, no, don't worry. Alexa's listening.
Yes, it really is. And my daughter and my son-in-law's sister had her Alexa just turn itself on and answer a question. Yeah. So it's not just TikTok posts.
Yeah. Sending emails.
There is like,
without people's permission. The thing is, though, with this advent of, I mean, obviously it's been around for a very long time, but now it's so in the fore and in the public eye. There's so much more media attention and this frenzy about, can it do good? Can it do bad? All the cure, you know, health stuff, work stuff. But how does, as a mother and two young kids who use this ChatGPT to, you know, to do their homework, which is wrong.
To guide
how them. How do we regulate? Yeah, guide them. That's it. Guide them. But how do we regulate it? How do we make sure that as it's so in the public domain now and it's so accessible for younger kids, how do we regulate it? Make sure it's safe. Make sure that it's being used for good. Because it is used for bad, isn't it?
Yeah. That's a great question as well. I think it really is important that we do regulate it, and it is used for good. I think the biggest danger that we do have is somebody that's bad is using it for bad rather than it being the enemy itself.
Oh, well, good thing then we live in such a good, peaceful, harmonious world. We're safe, so I needn't worry. How silly of me, Nando.
Do you remember, for me, one of the things I always remember is my maths teacher sitting me down and saying, you need to learn maths. You're not going to be walking around with a calculator in your pocket. And how wrong was he?
Yeah.
Well. Like my phone has a calculator. That's rarely more than 5 meters away from me. That's not saying I shouldn't learn maths, but it is saying I can use that to help me when I am struggling, or to help me get further and solve issues that I might not be able to solve. Now, with artificial intelligence, we can not just do mathematic questions. We can use it for a whole scope of things. That, like, medical doctors are already using it to help them more effectively diagnose situations, diseases or problems within people that they wouldn't have picked up without it.
But how do they do that? How does basically something that's based on technology have the ability and insight to diagnose, say, something in a physical person when it's not a person having a dialogue saying, oh, my tummy aches or my head hurts? How does it do it?
Well, the doctor is using it as a tool to help him,
because it's a database.
Yeah,
you're putting data in
to help.
So
you're
it's the saying, person diagnosing it, and that just helps.
I think
but it, like, the doctor might sit there, and I'm talking slightly out of turn because we're talking medical, but you're putting the data in, so you can have a conversation with the patient and say, right, let's check your pulse, and put the information into the computer.
And it
takes all those things, and the doctor, even before AI came out, would check on the internet or would open up a manual. Now what we're doing is we're using a system that has got so much more data and is also calculating what's most likely to be there. So it's adding options that are more likely to be present.
Different layers to the diagnosis.
And now the doctor can go, oh God, I didn't even think about that. Maybe he is diabetic, or maybe he is this. And they can explore that, which leads us to being healthier.
We have to leave it on that note, but it's a positive note.
It is a
positive note. AI is coming, it's here, and that is a reality that Nando is going to help us navigate and understand. But something that has been a reality and is here is the golden visa. If you invest more than 500,000 euros into Spain, you automatically get a residency. But it would seem that might not be an ongoing thing. Let's find out more with Christina Seccoli. Make my day.
Good morning, Spain. Well, here we are in Marbella, in Puerto Banús. And I want to actually tell you and ask you, there is news about that the golden visa may be abolished. And there is a lot of protesting because we don't think people who are in the business, construction, everybody who is in the bill, anything to do with houses, don't want it to happen, because the golden visa are very wealthy people. They come here and they want to buy something, which is a minimum of 500,000 to get the golden visa, but that doesn't mean that they buy a house for 500,000. They may be buying a house for 3 million or 2 million or 1.5 million or 500,000. So we are really concerned that this law is not going to happen. We want it to continue as is. The golden visa is very good for all of us in business, for the people that are in construction, for the people that are in real estate, for the people that are furniture people, for the people that have restaurants. Everybody wants to have very good clients. And everybody is here in the port lives with the money that they make. And they make the money from the people that are here spending. So we don't want the golden visa to be abolished. We want the golden visa to continue. And let's hope it will, because there's a lot of issues about it. And we hope that the popular voice will be, please keep it there. Lawyers, tax advisors, notaries, registrations, it's all extra sales. And it's a good point for selling as well, because the golden visa means that you can have your residence, providing you buy a property for more than $500,000. So what is a property $500,000? Well, here in Puerto Banús, prices for a two-bedroom start at about €450,000. Why? Because Puerto Banús offers everything. It's got a marina, it is very close to Marbella, it's close to the golf courses, and Puerto Banús is special. You can eat, you can drink at any time of the day or night. You can buy Saturdays, Sundays, where the big stores are closed unless it's the height of the season. So here we are. My office is open till 12 at midnight in the summer. And in the weekends, we're open now till about 10 o'clock at night. And we're also open in the morning at 9:30. So we work throughout the day, and we are there to receive you and give you advice and give you my experience, which is more than 40 years. So I wish you to come. I want you to come to Spain. The golden visa is still valid. We can sell your house for $500,000. You can get your residence. And let's take it from there. You're going to enjoy it. Good morning, Spain.
This was sponsored by me, Christina Sekuli.
Kate, how was your experience with aerial acrobatics and silk?
I think, as you say, we walked in and was expecting, honestly, I think like a swan in a lake. That's how I expected myself to be. And let's just say, it definitely was not that.
I mean, it's really, which is why I think it's appropriate that Kate shares this experience with you, Nando, because you're from the, you know, you've had marine background. It was commando hauling up these ropes to wrap one's legs around it, to swing into positions.
To hoik yourself up. And I'm not even joking about the pain in your legs when you were up there.
Physical workout.
Physical. No, honestly, I was sweating. And the upper body strength that you need to have, like you say, is on another level.
Yeah, like, not to take anything away from aerial acrobatics, because it looks incredibly hard, yeah. And there's a lot. Where you've got this mixed up, the Royal Marines do not roll around on pink silks.
Oh, I've got you all wrong.
I'm not
down
sure.
There.
Where
what
is
do you mean?
That's the army. You're thinking of the army, not the Royal Marines, all right? Brilliant.
Your name came up in conversation because the poor child, I mean, hanging upside down, but then there's some bits when you're wrapped around and literally the silks were wrapped around your legs.
Yeah.
You're dangling as if you're in parachute training.
It was like parachute training, actually, wasn't it? Because as you say, you're up there with the silks, like, wrapped, as you say, in different directions around your legs, and you're holding onto the top of the silks, and you're just swinging
in the
wind.
It's quite high up as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I'm saying to Kate, I was like, how are you going to get... I'm thinking, where's the teacher? Where's the teacher? How's she going to get down? But no, once you've got it, like, the courage together, literally just unwound herself by flipping downwards. But when, at one point, Kate was like, this is scary. And I never even thought about it. Yes. And it was like, okay, stop.
You do need to put quite a lot of trust, obviously, into I guess, yeah, into this gorgeous silk, because it is like completely holding you together. And if you do one kind of wrong flip, then you're literally toast.
You're falling, yeah.
On the floor.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. And even when you're spinning down, you've never done it before. How do you know how low your head is hanging when you're letting yourself unravel on these silks? But then you see the little tiny ones. They're up and down like nothing, but then again, they've got less body weight to haul.
The kids are fearless, aren't they? Like, that's the right time to get everybody started in these kind of things. Now I'd be like, oh, this is quite high.
But I think that's the thing what's most disheartening, because you see these little girls and they're so gorgeous little dollies, and they're flying up legs, like arms everywhere, and you're looking at them and you're like, oh my God, okay, now it's me, isn't it? And obviously it was just not the case. I think in my head, I imagined it to be like the teacher, you know, so dainty and gorgeous, and she was like, look, she was adorable, wasn't she? She's like a little rocket. And she did it so lovely, so beautifully. And she was like, right, okay, now you'll go. It's easy. And obviously,
it's easy.
Exactly. Just but like I think that. Anyone who does something, they think whatever they do is easy because they do it. But at first, they had Kate in this tiny, like, the silk was in like a little strip under a tushy. It was only then later that she said, oh no, you actually can widen it out and make it more of a swing seat. Exceedingly brave.
Oh, thank you.
Very proud of you getting into this gung-ho. Yeah. Okay, we've tried it. And that's basically what the objective is of this segment, is that we try things, we, the royal we try things.
Literally.
And then you can see what they're about and know if it's something that perhaps is up your street.
I think it's a great idea. What a brilliant idea for a segment. Have you thought about skydiving?
Actually, now that you've said that...
Are you up for it, Nando?
I have, because I met an amazing skydiver that we had on the show just few weeks back. So it's not off the cards, what can I say?
Do you know what? I think there's a lot of things that I wouldn't say no to, because do you know what? If you never try, you'll never know.
I love
so
it.
So do you know what? Watch this space.
Watch this space. The younger they are, the easier to get them to do these daring things. Thank you so much, Kate, for your dedication to the programme.
Thank you.
Nice work.
Find this amazing retreat that we're organized in a 15th century monastery where you will feel brand new with the uplifting activities in the sacred places, with yoga, with kundalini, with breath work, explore the local nature and have a little bit of cultural activities like flamenco and paella, as well as delicious foods. The stargazing is out of this world, and you'll sleep super well in the monk cells, feeling the energy of this monastery. Come join us.
Linea Director are sponsors of Good Morning Spain, and we have them as part of the team because we really do trust their service and know that they do the best of their ability to help their clients resolve issues, particularly us foreigners living abroad, which is why I had to laugh at myself and to myself the other day, because I got to my car and saw that my tire was punctured. Well, I knew it was flat. I didn't really know the reason why. My first thought was like, oh my God, I don't know if I've got a jack. Do I have a spare tire? So I started looking for the spare tire, couldn't find it in the boot. I was told by a neighbor I should look underneath the car. I did that, couldn't see anything. And it was ages till I suddenly thought, well, what if I just ring my insurance company? So I picked up the phone, I rang Linea Director. They were ever so helpful. And in minutes, I had a tow truck come, pick up my car to take it to see what the problem was. I do know from previous experience that we should never drive a car if the tire's flat, because it can actually damage the wheel and God knows what else. So first tip is, if you see you've got a flat or punctured tire, don't drive it. Call a tow truck to take it to a garage. I was very lucky that the tow truck guy also let me travel with him to the garage I chose to have it repaired. So please, if you find that you puncture your tire and you're not really, or you've got a flat tire and you don't know what to do, don't panic. If you've got an insurance company, particularly, as I say, I know with Linea Director, you phone them up, they send someone out, they'll either pump up the tire or they'll take you somewhere that you can get it fixed easily.
Hello and good morning, Spain. Today we're going to be making a salad with pimientos del piquillo, which is a jarred red pepper, which in Spain they take their jarred food and their tinned food very seriously. So there's really quality products that we can make some fantastic salads and dishes with these jarred and tinned goods. So today I'm going to show you a really easy recipe how to make a really fantastic salad using some of these jarred peppers. So I've got a bit of lettuce here. I'm just going to lay that on the plate. This is a really easy recipe because we're going to do all the chopping on the board and just lay everything up as we go. So we've got this lettuce on the plate. Next, I want to do a nice line of beautiful red tomatoes, and then we're going to start getting chopping. First of all, avocado. Get that in half. Let's scoop out the middle all the way around. And then we're just going to slice that up as well, and that's going to go on top of our tomatoes. If we just do slices along, keeping the shape of the avocado, if we just slice, push it against our knife, and we'll get a really nice long piece. So we can take that and just put it on the side of our salad like that. So next up, we've got our peppers, some feta cheese, and some chopped red onion, which I've already done. So we're just going to chop up our red peppers in nice little squares. Join them up like that. Chopping one way, chopping the other. And I'll do the same with these two here. Chopping one way and chopping the other. So what we're going to do now is incorporate all the rest of the ingredients on the chopping board in the chopping board. So I've got some capers here. Just going to chop them up too. Chopping them one way and chopping another. I don't want it to be really fine. I want to keep those textures there too. So we've got our feta, we've got our onion, and we've got our capers. Just a bit of seasoning now, a bit of pepper on top of this. And because the feta is quite salty, we're going to be quite careful with the salt, just salting the onion and the peppers. A little bit of lemon juice. And now we're just going to slice along with our feta and just go all the way along and incorporate everything together. I want to get some textures here, so I don't mind big pieces of feta or little pieces. I just want to get a bit of variety. Give this a nice good mix up on your board. You can tell from the colours it's going to taste fantastic. So let's do some plating up. We've already got our base ready to go, so we just need to sprinkle some of this magic on top. And we know it's already going to be a good salad. This is a great little tapper as well, straight onto a piece of bread, and it will be lovely. Finish this off again with a little bit of parsley, a little bit of molten salt on top of your avocado and on top of the mix, a little squeeze of lemon juice, and of course, olive oil. Let's get that over the top. Perfect. And that is my red pepper salad. Thank you very much and good morning. Let's get in and do some tasting. Okay, let's get on to the best bit here, using a bit of bread as a fork, standard in Spain. Just scooping up some of this lovely mix. Gonna get a bit of avocado on there too. This is just delicious. Mm. Such a good combination. Mm. Give that a try at home, guys. Thanks very much. Good morning.
Good morning, Spain. This week, I'm going to be talking about some more fiction set in Spain, some great books that I haven't yet mentioned. There's one called The Shadow of the Wind. It's a 2001 novel by Spanish writer Carlos Ruiz Zafón. It was originally published in Spanish as La Sombra del Viento. It was a worldwide bestseller, selling over 15 million copies. The novel is kind of a story within a story. It opens in the 1940s with the protagonist Daniel, a boy whose father owns a bookshop in Barcelona. One day, his father takes him to the Cemetery of Forgotten Books, a secret labyrinth library that houses rare and banned books. Daniel is drawn to one called The Shadow of the Wind and takes it home with him. He quickly reads it and falls in love with the story. He soon discovers that the book's mysterious author has gone missing, along with every other copy of the book. So he sets out to find out what's happened to the author and his books. Stephen King actually said of this book, "If you thought the true Gothic novel died in the 19th century, this will change your mind. Shadow is the real deal." Then we have The Drago Tree by Isobel Blackthorn. It's the first book in her Canary Islands collection, published in 2015. The author has a long-standing relationship with the Canary Islands, having lived in Lanzarote in the late 80s. The Drago Tree is about geologist Anne Salter, who seeks sanctuary in the island of Lanzarote. There she meets charismatic author Richard Parry and indigenous potter Domingo, and together they explore the island. Anne's encounters with its hidden treasures becomes a journey deep inside herself as she struggles to understand who she was, who she is, and who she wants to be. Set against a panoramic backdrop of dramatic island landscapes and Spanish colonial history, The Drago Tree is an intriguing tale of betrayal, conquest, and love. Then we have The Tale of Senyor Rodriguez by Lou Gilmond, published in 2011. Picture the scene. It's 1960s Mallorca. There's a dead man's house, a dead man's clothes, and a dead man's wine cellar. Enter Thomas Sebastian, an English con man who's hiding out in the house of the late Senyor Rodriguez, carousing, partying, and falling in love with his beautiful but impossibly young neighbour, Isabella Ferretti. As the boundary between lies and reality blurs, Thomas's fiction spirals out of control in ways that are quite unexpected. Then we have The Muse, a 2016 book by Jessie Burton, who I interviewed on my book show after the publication of The Miniaturist, which became a huge bestseller. The Muse is about a Caribbean immigrant in 1960s London and a Bohemian woman in 1930s Spain, who are bound together by a painting rumoured to be the work of a genius artist and the mystery surrounding his death. It's the story of two young women and the powerful mystery that ties them together. It's an enthralling tale of desire, ambition, and the ways in which the tides of history inevitably shape and define our lives. And finally, Sleeping Arrangements by Madeleine Wickham. This one was published in 2001. Madeleine Wickham is actually the real name of Sophie Kinsella, who wrote the best-selling Shopaholic series, made into lots of films. Sleeping Arrangements is one of the seven novels she wrote as Madeleine before changing or getting the pseudonym Sophie Kinsella. It's about two couples who rent out their friend's luxury villa in Spain, not knowing that he's double booked, so they're all there at the same time. What makes things worse, or maybe more interesting, is that a man and a woman from each of the two couples actually have a history together. Enjoy.
Hi, I'm Monica.
Hi, I'm Paula.
We are sisters and we are here to talk to you because we are the founders of Family Support Group.
And we bring you the doctors, caregivers and nurses to your own house for help you.
Our mom wanted to be at home and we had problems with the healthcare system in Spain because you must talk with a lot of doctors, you must try to investigate many things and many information, and we were absolutely alone.
We can bring you all the medical service to your house.
We want to be your family support group.
No one needs to pass away in a hospital or in a hospice. You can be in your own house with your family. Call us. We are here for you.
This segment is sponsored by the School of Canine Science.
And now it's time to snouten about. I do love the title you came up with for your segment, Snouting and Abouting, because it covers absolutely everything.
Brilliant.
What's our topic of the day, Nando?
So today we're going to talk about a charity that's very close to my heart. I'm an ambassador for the charity, and they are called Hero Paws. Oh. And what they do is they look after and help rehabilitate dogs that have been in service. So ex-police dogs, ex-military dogs, ex-special forces dogs. Because unfortunately, around the world, different governments deal with war dogs in different ways.
Some, like the veterans?
Yeah, very much so.
Not always as looked after as they deserve.
Yeah, yeah, 100% so. And it's almost, I don't want to compare it, but it's a terrible way that they're dealt with. So a lot of dogs, once they finish their service, are euthanized. So.
Oh, that's a nice thank you.
Yeah, well, this is exactly it. We're talking about dogs that have gone out and saved the lives of hundreds of soldiers, right? Or they've been put in a position where they are with special forces teams and going into incredibly dangerous zones. And they're either kept in kennels, they're put to sleep, or they're discarded, and it's a horrific ending to such a heroic life.
Yeah.
And there's a charity called Hero Paws, which helps to, at the moment they're trying to raise funds so that they can build a centre so that these dogs can come in and have time to decompress. Like veterans that have come from a war zone need that time to be able to readjust. Mm. Dogs need the same kind of setup. And once they've had the time to readjust, some of those dogs can go on and live incredibly happy retirements as a pet. Aww. So they will rehome these dogs. They'll find the suitable people that are right for these dogs, and they'll make sure that the dog is right as well. And they give support as well. So they help the dog readjust once it's fit into a home. So it's such an incredible charity. It's such an important thing, because at the end of the day, these dogs have served time. Like, it's a massive mission.
It is,
they're,
as you say, heroes,
yeah,
that then are just discarded, which is unthinkable. I love the idea of rehoming them, but if they can't be rehomed, at least having a centre,
yeah,
where they can live out their days in dignity.
Yeah. Exactly that. So it's really important. So they're trying to raise enough funds to build a centre at the moment. But in the meantime, they still take on various different dogs. They help them get them fostered so that they can readjust. They help with the training. They help with the veterinary bills, the whole thing. It's like a real big package. Aww. So I urge everybody to go and check out Hero Paws and just to like follow them on social media so that they can keep up to date with how this is progressing, because we need to start putting pressure on the governments to say that's not okay. Right? They've done their time, now it's our turn to look after them.
Yeah, definitely.
Undeniably.
Yeah.
That's a horror story without a doubt. I was not expecting that.
Crazy, isn't it? Crazy.
Because whereabouts is it based? Is it here?
It's a UK-based charity.
Yeah.
And we're talking about dogs that are like have seen the most horrific end of war.
Yeah, right? I can't even imagine.
What do they use for dogs for? Is sniffing out bombs and things
so they
like
have,
that?
So they have various dogs that sniff out explosives, but also you have dogs that are going in, and when an environment is unsafe for a human to go in, they'll often send a dog in first, and they'll send a dog in to neutralize a target, to clear an area. So they're used in various aspects, and a lot of these dogs love their job, right? And that in itself is a difficult conversation, because people are, well, should we even be taking dogs to war? Like, it is happening. Right, so the ethics around that is a whole different subject.
Yeah.
But it is happening. It's what happens afterwards.
Exactly, and I think that is definitely something that is in our hands.
Yeah.
It's something that we can get involved with and support. Thank you for sharing that with us.
Thank you for...
The ambassador of Hero Paws, Nando Brown, and that was a perfect topic for snouting about. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I kind of think that's all we have time for this week. We really hope you've enjoyed the programme. We've enjoyed putting it together, sharing information. And so we will see you next week. But please do follow us on social media and our website, and also watch the recordings on our YouTube channel, Good Morning Spain TV. And if you've got any queries or comments, drop us a line. We'd love to hear from you. Thank you so much. Should we say goodbye?
Say goodbye.
Bye. 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 Bye.